let them know, okay? Yep. You get to see our face.
You can, Daniel said you could remove the middle row, and that would probably still be an option for him.
We can. Yeah, we can. Yeah. And it's okay, yeah, it's good, it's fine, we have good room. Entrance. Sit down, wait a moment.
So I'm in the spots, a little bit way back, and I'm starting with this series of drawings down there. I worked for 4 years scratching obsessively at pieces of photographic paper, which, because I'm doing an obsessive job. So this image is an image of a young white guy in South Africa getting his head shaved in the winter. And I wanted a really simple idea, just make a really photorealistic drawing that looks like a photograph, and if you approach it up really closely, it's just a whole series of minutes and minutes of scratches on photographic paper. I take the paper, expose it to light, and process it, and it turns completely black. And I spent those 4 years scratching away. Not that this is a whole series of drawings of guys having their heads shaved. I really went to a military base in South Africa called Third South African Infantry. And during apartheid, I grew up during apartheid, all white boys were, it was not just mandatory, it was law. You had to go to the military, sign up, and become part of the apartheid killing machine, really, because you'd be expected to do that. You could become what they call a conscientious objector, and if you did that, you were thrown in jail, or you could avoid conscription by going to study, which is what I did. And that's how I got out of doing military service. But my brother did, I've got an older brother, he's 13 years older than me, and I don't even know why he joined the military, because he didn't have to, he volunteered. I was born in Zambia, so he wasn't even a national. But anyway, this was how I started thinking about what happens to a guy when he joins the military. He gives up his individuality, his own identity, and becomes part of this big collective, which is the army. And that was the first series of drawings that I made for transitions. And after thinking about a military head shaving, I started thinking about other transitions. And what happened is, so this is the whole installation that I made, and it starts with a circumcision, just a bit of a disclaimer, it's quite expressive. And the next series of drawings is a baby circumcision that I managed to take from the frame. We had a son, and they wanted to have their baby circumcised. I managed to speak to the doctor. It was a secular circumcision, so it wasn't religious. Very weird experience. It was very quiet. There was no screaming and shouting. There was a local anesthetic, and the whole thing was covered in fluid. And I wanted to. I was circumcised as a baby, and that's true. But I felt that I had to own this process in order to survive. I wanted people to ask questions about what happens to a person when they transition from one state of being to another. And these things, that operation happened in literally 5 minutes. And then there was a Lebanese Maronite Catholic wedding that I documented and scratched. My dad is Lebanese, so he would have gone through this process with my mom. The bride and the groom is a crowd, like a king and queen process. And then I went on to something called the man is a bit older, and just something more mundane and more quotidian. He's just ultimately I ended up with people just going through the turnstiles at a train station. And with that show, it was the most amazing experience. It went to the Smithsonian National Museum of American Art. It was a huge project that I did with a series of lithographs, and there was a film attached to the project too. And then it came here. That show was here at the Brown Center. And that's why I thought I would start with this series of works. And it was also an amazing experience, of course. And that was the first time. And then the lithographs that I made with the project were put up at Goya, which is just... So the lithographs are also scratched just from dark to light on a lithographic stone, which is a huge piece of limestone. Roll up the whole stone in black with black ink, and then just spent months and months scratching away the black to the white to make the images. And those are sort of the results. Then I can show you little extracts of the film. Because it's 14 minutes, I'm not gonna. And then it brings next to a mountain or a mall. And then I did the same thing again in Maputo and Mozambique. And then I did the Lost in France, which was, I think, I forgot another one, which is showing. This just shows the process of how my neighbors.
So the sharing Vietnam has got to do with the, you know, constricted people often have shared it. That's why it's true. Okay.
Also, I love it. Shall I go?
Thank you.
front, normal front on Monday.
Was this all done in the same day?
Good enough. No, it took a good couple of days. We had like a week to do all the photography because we had to hire off that studio and draw them on or paint them on or scratch them on. I wanted the light. Photography is about light. And that's what appealed to me. And because photography has a particular relationship with memory and monumentalizing, I see photographs as miniature monuments. I think that's one of the reasons why documents.
So the sharing of Vietnam has got to do with the.
And this was kind of the result of the installation. That's the monument that it went up right next to. Why this monument? Because on the walls of this monument, there are 72,000 names of men who died in World War I, British and French names. And the South Africans fought with the British. We wore British uniforms. We were a British protectorate at the time. Sorry, we're talking about 1914. It was a very different world. There was no bill of individual human rights. I was really intrigued about what it would take to make a whole bunch of men hurl themselves over the tops of trenches and basically kill themselves. We had a really good chance to die. It was really kind of a machine of industrial deal. It's very different to what it was now. But the unbelievably relevant thing for me is that on the walls of this monument, there are no Black South Africans on the walls at all. It was inconceivable that Black men would take up arms against white men 100 years ago. And so many of them died. It was a volunteer service, but they weren't memorialized in the same way at all. So I chose men's names from everywhere. I chose them at random. There were Black South Africans with white South Africans, with German names, with Jewish names, with Chinese names, it was literally, the World War I was a world war. Nearly the whole world was involved. There are a lot of questions around representing other ethnicities in our white skin. I've only used my body for those images. These are just some of the images from that. I was denied permission to put up this installation, and it was only the mayor who allowed me to do his mention. He said, I'm just going to whiz through this, otherwise I'm going to keep it too long. We had a celebration on the opening day, we had some champagne, and it was quite an amazing feeling to have something like this put up. People are very posting all of their comments about the excavation on the forum, and I just kept a record of everything. There were some real beauties. I love this one. The artist has managed to come up with something even more pointless. There were also lots of good comments too, and it was a great article in the paper. But that's what I really like about public art. It's not the gallery or the museum audience that's going to see your work. It's Joseph from down the road who suddenly sees this thing and has a reaction. And I think it was a big lesson for me to be cool with it, no matter what it was. I like it. I'm open to it. I wasn't always. It's sort of grown as I've gotten older. And there was a really nice thing happened where it was included in a history book written by a historian, which was wonderful. That's what was left in the installation, just these rags. And I just went there, bundled it all up, put it back into a tube. And that was after 3 months that it was like that. So it got ripped to shreds. And then I turned those shreds into a museum show called Memories, which went to Boston at Boston University. And I exhibited them with the molds that I used for making photographs. And that's just a couple of shots of what looked like in that space. It was previously it was a show of Cadillacs, which I also quite liked. And then that was a touring show, so it's ended up being shown in a couple of places in South Africa too. This is at the Lebanese Art Museum in Bloemfontein, South Africa. And then it went to this art museum, and I exhibited all of the installations, the ones from Mozambique, from Grahamstown, and France, for that show. That's just a couple of shots. Then, along came Remember Dismember. Remember Dismember is a video work that I made, which I can let you watch. It's only 3 minutes. democracy that he brought into law. And so that was the reason why I wanted to subvert this idealized idea of a man on a horse being this incredibly phallic symbol of power and have this soft skin of a man's body projected onto it with these man's breast inches. I like that kind of juxtaposition of hard stone with the softness of the body. That is the reason why I chose that one. And that was just an intervention that happened one night at the Union Buildings, and I just recorded that. Then I can show you some things around one of my next, my last show, which was 2020. Substance of Shadows, which I probably can get to show you, which is this here. Substance of Shadows was at the University of Johannesburg Art Gallery. It's 6 years of work. I did this part of it during the pandemic, and it's mostly during the years of I looked after both my parents. They were really old. My mom was 86 and my dad was 92 when he passed away. And I had the last roll of the carbon paper that was ever produced in South Africa, I think. And it's a black roll of carbon paper. And that's stuff that you used to come between. Because it's got and used. You also get it in blue, so there's a blue carbon. And I just took the blade and I scraped away all of the carbon black, and all you're left with is this sort of semi-transparent thing. And all of the works on this show are made of carbon paper. That's just a couple of images I'm scratching away. And I mean, some of the works are sculptural, so I've scraped away all the carbon and then stitched the patterns together to make a garment. A lot of gay boys, I forgot to tell you this. I mean, I've always been interested in clothing and fashion and how. I think a lot of gay people, maybe I'm not generalizing, but I certainly was. Because clothes are such powerful signifiers, they hardly want to present yourself to the world. Even people who don't want to take part in the fashion conversation are actually still taking part because nobody's even being naked is a fashion statement. This is a work that I made while my mother was in real cognitive decline. My mom suffered from and died of Alzheimer's when she was over 60. And this is a veil. I took a photograph of her in the wedding veil and made her, this is a replica of that wedding veil. Scraped away all of the carbon, this 1 year's work, and then constructed the veil, which you see in the background. The other works like this one here is my body with the old South African flag insignia on my body, and I turned it into a kind of a really tall wallpaper. This I call a self-portrait, that's one of my reasons, and expressed it to you. And this is my dad. So, my dad was Lebanese, conservative, Christian, Catholic, and he actually allowed me to photograph him naked one day. It took a long time to convince him to let me do it. I think he eventually let me do it because he trusted me. And he used to say things like, I think you're being too arty. I said to him once, my dad, I would not ask you to do anything that I haven't done myself because I've been naked. something in my words, but I don't know if you found that very comforting because I don't know if guys will do that to us. But he allowed me to do it. And then I said to wear his image on a piece of paper, on a piece of carbon paper that's the same dimensions as the Shard of Turin. The Shard of Turin is quite a famous Catholic relic that was supposed to have to inform the body of Jesus Christ when he was taken down from the cross. And his, it's, you know, the Catholic sort of dogma doesn't say either way whether they think it is authentic or not. It's been disproved, it's been proven to be a fake so many times with various scientific tests, but it still gets a lot of attention from people who believe that it is the real Shard that held the Book of Christ. And so I just subverted that whole thing with my own hands. My carbon did it. This was my head with insignia from World War I projected onto the front of my face with the insignia from my father's jacket projected onto the back of my head. And just some details. Rough color, I did the same technique. Months scraping it away and then stitched the whole thing together to make the collar. It's a European collar that would have signified a great deal of status of the wearer. And this collar's information I made out of collars that would have been used for different occasions by men. And I used buttons, little piece kind of studs that you could kind of find in my dad's possessions to get them together. They all have slightly different designs. It's actually the title of yours. Some details. This is Armand Richard Everett. It's myself here with the Everett projected onto my skin.
Yeah, so like my very first like moments of the army, like I was like this class clown of, you know, oh, that's the guy that was in his underwear, you know? Being 19 years old, covered in blood, thinking of gunpowder and explosives and like the brake fluid from the Humvee has a smell, burning flesh has a smell. You know, maybe this military life is for me. Like, this is the place where I know people will always be looking out for each other. Like, we're always going to be together. You detach yourself and you're just like wearing a skin suit, basically. You're just like watching your body like do the things that it's supposed to do. Being in your 20s, a glorified frat house almost. A platoon, a squad, like you have this tight bond, so we work together. Being a part of like a commando unit that everyone is trained to be the sensor, to be a part of that phalanx that, you know, is always looking out for your left and your right and your buddies, and that level of trust that we all have, knowing that everybody is looking where everybody else is stepping. We're all doing everything possible to bring each other home. We're all stuck in this boat. Like, you build a relationship. I guess the playfulness, it's probably completely natural. Like, for all boys to pee-pees and it's slapping with towels and like all those things. I guess it's male bonding. Like, and no matter like how homoerotic it looks on the outside, like, chances are there's like zero sexual intention. We call it gay chicken, of like how close you can get to being like super homo about something without like actually crossing the line of like touching wieners or like anything like that. I'm probably one of the few champions of gay chicken. The drill sergeants, like they threatened that if anybody collapsed and fell out because of the heat, that they would give them a Turkish IV. Turkish IV is taking the bag, like the fluid bag, putting the hose on, taking the catheter off, and then sticking that directly into the rectum. So that way, the fluids are absorbed the fastest. So then, I took this idea, because I like to get a laugh out of people, and I was like, I'm gonna take a Turkish IV. I was like, wow, that's cold and I feel rehydrated. And stood up and, you know, got my pants around my ankles. I'm like, thanks, Doc, you saved my life. The laughter from, the whole platoon, and I started laughing, and as I'm laughing, my sphincter's doing this, and like I'm squirting IV fluid out of my ass.
Skirmishes that the apartheid government took part in Mozambique. Lots of South African names, no focused on those things. Bali wasn't in government in 2007. And then the World War One, you can get plenty of names, you can find online. It's just the difference between how they were memorialized between black and white South Africans. And I just selected them. Exposed to a situation that has a deep impact on the body that resonated with me. I wanted to make a memorial. I didn't know the words counter-monument, anti-monument. Those words came much, much later. I'm not a very intellectual person actually when I'm making work. It's kind of intuitive. I felt as if I had been affected in a physical way and in a mental way and a spiritual way and an emotional way by a traumatic event, and it stays on the skin. It stays because what happens to your body and your mind are interconnected. That was the main reason for wanting to make something like that. And the impressions that are kept onto the skin stay. They stay behind for a little while. And I want to capture that and make something that didn't last, actually. Because memorials and memory, we have this idea that it's going to last forever. But it doesn't. It's actually a monument to forget it. That's where the whole impression is.
I was just wondering how you kind of handled speaking for all these communities and like your
very generously, generally. For World War One, it was very difficult. There was nothing I could do really that was going to include the families of the names that I have put onto my skeleton. And very important, I have never wanted to honor anyone. That was something, because I have a lot of issues with the idea of honor anyway, I did not want to qualify the putting of names on my body as an honoring of someone. I've got German names next to Jewish names. I have South African names next to white South Africans next to black South Africans. There are a lot of boundaries that I'm crossing by that act. It's different with the veterans now because, and that is the reason why I wanted to talk about a war that is happening now. My dad is Lebanese. The conflicts in the Middle East that are going on that America is involved in has been for ages now. And this whole thing, even between Gaza and Israel, is impacting on Lebanon too. That's why I'm interviewing American soldiers and I'm also interviewing Lebanese soldiers. I've just recently, literally like in the last few days, managed to get voice notes. This is how I'm doing. I'm working with voice notes of a Lebanese soldier who's in Lebanon, in the military. I'm not allowed to know his name. I'm not allowed to interview him directly. I am not allowed to photograph him. He's not allowed to say certain things. But he has a friend in Paris who speaks English and Arabic and is translating his Arabic for me, and I have the voice note. And I'm wanting to combine the stories that the American soldiers are telling with the Lebanese stories in Arabic. I don't quite know how I'm going to do that yet. But that's a very different relationship because they can tell me to follow up if they want to. And they do sometimes. Not everybody's going to want to speak to me. That's how, and it's really, I'm just going up to veterans and saying, would you like to be part of my project? And most of them have said, sure. That's literally how I'm doing it. And it's not so easy. A lot of veterans are not particularly interested in talking because I'm an outsider, I'm a queer boy, and I'm not American. That's also part of the relationship. It's a more balanced kind of power structure, I think.
We love you more!
Yes.
Thank you.
That was a day that work was made just when the Marikana miners massacre happened in South Africa. Marikana is a mine. It's a platinum mine. And in 2000, and I can't remember what the exact year was, there was a massacre of miners who were striking. And Cyril Ramaphosa, who is our current president, was on board of a long miners. And he authorized. He wasn't alone. There were a whole bunch of people who were doing it. But I had some of those names, those ones to go to my work too. And I wore a business suit.
And
for
this is for reconstruction of certain uniforms or
orange, blue and white belt with a big gold buckle. That was an old apartheid South African buckle that I found. And then it was a business suit and it was a contemporary South African military uniform and red, that sort of eagle kind of insignia. That's what I did. And it just goes in chronological order. It just goes around and around and around. Just an endless cycle of war that never stops. Yeah. Obsessed with religion.
Oh, yes. Also, yeah. Well, I see a book previously. Now that I'm looking at it again, I realize it's a little bit just me, but there's a pattern of absence of subtraction. You seem to be drawn to that absence. Is there a reason why?
Probably. even before transitions happened, I think that a lot of my work is motivated and it started with broken relationships with me. I think I've spent most of my life trying to figure out what absence of belonging, and I'm very interested in ideas of masculinity and vulnerability and how those two concepts just are so uncomfortable with each other. That I've had a lot of clothes that have nobody in them. And a lot of my real work. So that whole washing line is also inspired by clothing and empty clothing. Those sculptures of